He's been one of the most controversial choices on the Hall of Fame ballot in the last decade. He never had a steroid scandal, never was arrested, he led multiple teams deep into the playoffs, and he holds all-time batting records. Yet, he is still seen as irresponsible, hot-headed, a punk, a loser, and the centerpiece of multiple terrible trades. Never the one to back down or put in minimal effort, he went from getting kicked off school teams to All-Star games and World Series home runs. This mustached rebel enraged everyone, from legendary teammates to the sports media on two coasts. What's his deal? Why is he so controversial? If he has a pretty solid resume, why is there so much heated discussion about if he belongs in the Hall of Fame? This video is a look at the life of Jeff Kent and his eternal quest to prove the haters wrong. In total, for his career, Jeff had over 2,400 hits, 1,500 RBIs, a .290 career batting average, multiple Silver Slugger awards, a five-time All-Star, an MVP award. In summary, a whole lot of strong numbers. Especially for someone who barely liked baseball at all. Just like many other kids growing up outside of Los Angeles in the 70s and 80s, Jeff got really into skateboarding and motocross. The son of a motorcycle cop who raced motocross, Jeff's blood ran so thick with the need for two-wheeled speed, even going to Dodger games couldn't get him into baseball. Unlike a great deal of future pros, Kent was not a fan of baseball growing up, thinking it was a slow and boring game that he would not watch on TV. Even though he was an intimidating hitter with a nasty pitching arm, Kent was asked to leave his high school baseball team for his senior year after a dispute with coaches. Missing out on the crucial year to make his name known to baseball scouts, Kent enrolled as a student at UC Berkeley after graduation. By the springtime of his freshman year, the Golden Bears baseball coach, Bob Milano, asked Kent to be a walk-on for Cal's team. Kent produced right away. In his sophomore year, Kent and the Bears made it to the 1988 College World Series. Jeff's junior year, in 1989, saw a weaker California team, and this is again where Kent ran into disagreement with coaches, causing uneasiness in the clubhouse. After the end of the college season, Jeff elected for the draft over playing out his senior year. The 1989 MLB amateur draft was chock full of future greats. The White Sox picked future Hall of Famer Frank Thomas with the 7th overall pick. Future teammate of Kent, Jim Thome, was picked in the 13th round. And the then shortstop prospect, Trevor Hoffman, was chosen with the 290th pick. With the 523rd overall pick in the 20th round, the Blue Jays selected Jeff Kent from the University of California, Berkeley. Kent pushed through the Toronto minor league system with blazing speed. The young, hard-hitting infielder was invited to the Blue Jays' 1992 spring training, where he made a strong impression. He was named to the team, and on April 12, 1992, made his major league debut against the Baltimore Orioles. Kent quickly became a regular in the Toronto starting lineup, playing along a strong team of veterans like Roberto Alomar, Dave Winfield, Joe Carter, John Olerud, Al Leader, Dave Steib, David Wells, Tom Henke, Jack Morris, and Candy Maldonado. Jeff's time north of the border was limited, as on August 27th, Toronto made a deal with the New York Mets that traded Kent and a player to be named later in exchange for a year of premier starter David Cone. Toronto did go on to win the 92 World Series, with Cone being a key part of that title. But in retrospect, Blue Jay fans have gone on to consider the trade to be one of the worst moves in team history. In the end, Jeff was awarded a World Series ring for his early season contributions to the Blue Jays, even though the Mets failed to break 500 themselves. Kent's tenure in New York started off rocky. He hit poorly the rest of the 92 season. However, it was Kent's behavior that soured his arrival in Queens. During his first game with the Mets, Jeff strongly argued with an umpire over a call against him. And then in the same series, 2 days later, he threw his helmet and bat over a called strike three he disagreed with. Early in September, Jeff was then the target of a clubhouse prank for the newly acquired rookie. Teammates had swapped out his street clothes with a set from the team's announcer. Enraged by this, Kent barked at his teammates to return his clothes. Eventually, a clubhouse employee sought out manager Jeff Torborg for help, who grilled the team with an expletive-laden rant to end the situation. Kent defended his actions by attesting to the fact he had endured similar pranks with the Blue Jays, saying, quote, "I paid my rookie dues in Toronto." His offensive numbers began to increase with each season. For his time in New York, he held a .279 batting average and set the team record for home runs in a season by a second baseman with 21. All this time, though, the Mets continued to suck ass every season and were constantly below 500. Then, 1996 came around and a lot changed for Jeffrey. At the end of July, Jeff and teammate Jose Vizcaino were traded to the Cleveland for second baseman Carlos Borrega. This trade is also decried by fans as one of the worst moves in franchise history. In this trade, it was Kent who the contending team was signing a rental for. Cleveland would end the season with 99 wins, earning the AL Central pennant and having the best record in the MLB. In the 96 ALDS, this juggernaut squad took on the wildcard Baltimore Orioles. The Birds upset the Indians, taking the series 3-1. Only a few weeks after the conclusion of the World Series, one of the largest trades of the offseason took place when the San Francisco Giants traded longtime fan favorite third baseman Matt Williams to Cleveland for Julian Tavares, Jose Vizcaino, and Jeff Kent. To understand this trade in full context, I must introduce to us a wizard, the powerful mystic of Brian Sabeem. After working his way up among the lower ranks, Sabeem became the head of the Yankees scouting department in the late 80s. Under his guidance, the Yankees developed some of their greatest players in franchise history. Sabeem personally scouted out a young Derek Jeter while he was still in high school. Come draft day in 1992, Sabeem was the one who persuaded George Steinbrenner to choose the young shortstop with the 6th overall pick. As the Yankees were primed and ready to dominate the decade, Sabeem moved across the country and joined the Giants in 1993. 3 years later, Sabeem replaced the beleaguered Bob Quinn as the team's general manager after a trio of mediocre seasons. His first move in rebuilding as general manager was trading for Jeff Kent. Giant fans were not happy with this move. The trade was so unpopular that Sabeem had to speak out publicly about it and defend his actions, where among other things he said, quote, "I'm not an idiot." So far, we are 3-for-3 on all the trades involving Jeff Kent being controversial in one way or another. Under the guise of legendary manager Dusty Baker, Jeff was made the Giants' starting second baseman and would hit right behind he who must not be named in anything baseball related. In his first 3 years with San Francisco, Jeff averaged over 100 RBIs, almost 30 home runs, and 150 hits per season. What once was a hard-headed, rebellious rookie had now become the reliable, charity-donating, all-star second baseman that was now Jeff Kent. With all their electronics surviving Y2K, 2000 was the beginning of a competitive era for the Giants. San Francisco captured the best record in the National League while Jeff had his best season. He ended the year with a 334 average, an OPS over 1,000, and 125 RBIs. He won the Silver Slugger at second base, but more importantly, he was named the National League MVP. This was the first time since Ryan Sandberg in 1984, a second baseman was named the most valuable player. In an odd mirroring of his last time in the playoffs, the first-seeded Giants took on the wild-card New York Mets in the 2000 Divisional Series, only to be upset 3-1. After barely missing the playoffs in 2001, the Giants were set on making the 2002 season the year they put all the pieces together. Things started off bumpy when during spring training in early March, Kent reported to the Giants that he had broken his wrist when he fell off his pickup truck while cleaning it. Then, word started to trickle into the media that this was only a story Jeff had made up. What actually happened was Jeff had been riding his motorcycle near the Giants practice facility in Arizona, popping wheelies on public streets. A woman at the scene saw Jeff wheelie too hard, angle towards the curb, and crash the bike. She pulled up to the fallen 2000 NL MVP and said, quote, "You are an idiot." Jeff replied back with, quote, "Get the hell out of the way." Quickly, two vehicles arrived and picked Jeff up along with his bike. One vehicle was a truck owned by Kent. The other was a white van with a license plate that belonged to the San Francisco Giants. Another aspect of the scandal that has come to be known as Wheeliegate was in follow-up statements from Jeff. He openly acknowledged that riding motorcycles was against his contract. This did not stop him from regularly riding them, which Jeff also said that the Giants never had any problems with. He was never charged with anything criminal, as being an irresponsible dumbass on a motorcycle is the state sport of Arizona. Lurking below the surface of the Giants team that season was a power struggle about 5 years in the making. Hot-headed, loud-mouthed, and a fellow MVP winner, was seen as the obvious best player on the Giants, and therefore should be the clubhouse leader. But that was not the case, and when Jeff arrived in town, he began to challenge the dynamics of the team. Despite Jeff and John Dowd being the two leading players on the Giants, both were seen as cold and egotistical. The tension between these two stars made its most public appearance in late June 2002. After giving up five late runs and the lead against San Diego, cameras caught Kent and Reggie Stocker getting physical with one another in the dugout. This might have been what the entire team needed, though, as they would move on from this incident and end the 2002 season in second place, earning the wild card, bitches! Flipping the script this postseason, the Giants beat the first-seeded Braves in the NLDS and then gave the Cardinals a gentleman's sweep on their way to the 2002 World Series against the Anaheim Angels. The Giants initially took a 3-2 lead in the series. Game 6 saw San Fran push close to the finish line, with a 5-0 lead going into the 7th. Back-to-back three-run innings by the Angels nixed the Giants' chance of taking the series that day. The deciding Game 7, despite an early deficit, was a one-sided affair for Anaheim. With their 4-1 victory, the Angels had come back and won the World Series, their first and still only in franchise history. This comeback enraged Jeff. Sorry, my bad on the verb usage there. This comeback enrages Jeff, as still to the present day, the topic of his World Series Game 7 loss is what he seemingly defines not only himself, but his entire baseball career down to. Only 2 days after the World Series ended, Kent was granted his release from the Giants and became a free agent. With Dusty Baker replaced as the manager and wanting to be closer to his family now residing on a ranch in Texas, Jeff signed a deal with the Houston Astros. His arrival in Enron City was tense at first, as his last name did not begin with the letter B, but things cooled off very quickly for Beth Bent. He never had a large ego in Houston to contend with and seemed to fit into the team's lineup well. The Astros elected not to pick up his third-year option, and in late 2004, Jeff signed a 3-year deal with his hometown Los Angeles Dodgers. In Los Angeles, the veteran Kent found a formidable opponent in the form of Milton Bradley. Much like his previous time in the NL West, there was confusion over who was thought of as the team leader. Both Bradley and Kent thought they filled that role. As the season pressed on, the relationship between them grew more tense. In August 2005, Jeff called out Milton for not hustling enough after a play, and a shouting match erupted between them after a game in Florida. The doors to the clubhouse were sealed, and it was said Bradley threw a chair. Quickly after the end of the 2005 season, Mr. Anger Management Milton Bradley was traded away from the Dodgers before things got any worse for them. Kent remained on the team as he entered his elder years of playing. Once more a team with a winning culture, the 2008 Dodgers were now led by the dynastic manager, Joe Torre. Kent started off the year strong, but ended up on the DL for a good portion of the second half of the season. Taking the NL West pennant, LA swept the one-seeded Chicago Cubs in the first round of the playoffs, only to get bounced in the NLCS by the eventual world champion Philadelphia Phillies. Now in his 40s and having played over a decade and a half in the bigs, 2008 would be Jeff's last season. January 22, 2009, at a press conference in an unbuttoned shirt and tearing with emotion, Kent announced his retirement from baseball. In the speech given, he acknowledged his run-ins with teammates, as well as the Game 7 loss. But most importantly, he shouted out his haters. In retirement, Jeff did not intend to stop working. Already owning a cattle ranch in Austin, Texas, Kent moved there to live out his cowboy dream full-time. He opened up a line of successful motorsport dealerships as well as a large-scale sports complex. Jeff's stay at home was a short one, as he quickly tried his hand at reality TV shows. First, in 2009, he was an athletic contestant on the ABC reboot of Superstars, where he was paired up with the ex-Miss USA and Doritos girl, Allie Landry. The pair came in fifth place for the lone season of the show's reboot. Then came Jeff's largest casting. He was sent on a boat and dropped off in one of the most beautiful and remote locations in the world, the Philippines. Not for a Mormon mission, but for the 25th season of the hit reality show, Survivor. Within minutes of the first episode, Jeff twisted his leg, hampering his ability in the game. Kent claimed he sold motorbikes for a living and auditioned for the show by sending in a motocross tape.
I had an audition in Austin, so I sent in a motocross tape.
Tell us about your motocross.
Well, I'm not one of the pro guys. I don't make any money racing bikes. It's a hobby. How I make my money is selling motorcycles.
immediately, a tribe member recognizes that he is Jeff Kent.
I used to spend time with a guy who was really into baseball, and I know who Jeff Kent is. But there's been no mention of him being a former professional athlete who's made probably $30 million in his career.
She never calls him out directly on this, rather electing to use it to psychologically torture Jeff in the camp while hanging out at the shelter. She'd specifically bring up the topic of sports to rib the five-time All-Star.
Dawson starts talking a lot of sports, so I'm walking on eggshells right now, because right now I'm having a good time with these people just being normal, and I am normal. That's what I am. I used to be a ball player, no problem about it, but I'm normal. And if I end up putting two to two together, I'm in trouble.
Beginning to feel pressure from this, he quickly was able to get her voted off.
Dawson knows my history as an athlete. The best scenario might be just to vote her out.
Fifth person voted out of Survivor Philippines, Dawson.
Making it past the merge, Kent's play on Survivor had some parallels to how he conducted himself in baseball. But the lack of a roided-up phenom and enraged board game designer makes a full comparison difficult. It all caught up with him in Episode 8, when Jeff was completely blindsided by the merged tribe and became the second member of the jury. This is where Jeff gave the all-time greatest Survivor exit interview. Let us watch it in full.
You know what pisses me off? Is I think I've made about $60 million playing baseball, and I want this frickin' $1 million in this game. And it's not even $1 million, it's 600 grand by the time Obama takes it. I'm a Game 7 World Series loser. You know, I've played in the biggest games in the world and the worst games in the world, but this just sucks.
Since his elimination on Survivor, Jeff mainly adopted the typical dad life in Texas as his kids grew up. Keeping to himself mostly, he and his wife Dana are busy running a series of charitable organizations and scholarship funds. He has remained a fierce advocate for PED and drug testing in baseball, and it does not take a genius to see that his time in San Francisco is probably a large reason for that. 2014 was the first year Jeff appeared on the Hall of Fame ballot. He started slow with just 15% of the needed votes. By last year, Kent was now up to 32%. 2023 is Kent's last and final year on the Hall of Fame ballot. Among second basemen, Jeff Kent ranks number one for career home runs and RBIs, second for slugging percentage and career ejections, fourth for doubles, OPS, and OPS plus, top five for mustaches, first for motorcycle-related injury cover-ups, and is still the only player in baseball history to win an MVP and then go on to have a meltdown about Barack Obama on national television. The choice is simple. Jeff Kent has the resume to justify being in the Hall of Fame. For his era, when run production was the mode, Jeff Kent was the man. Prior to making this video, I did not have this position. He seemed to me to be a lame square. But from how he started, to where he went, to what he went up against time and time again, to the records he ended with, I now see the reality of the situation. That lame square proved every hater wrong. To all the voters in this year's selection process, as I know you are all watching, do the right thing. Elect the Game 7 loser. Or else you know what he will say.
I'm a Game 7 World Series loser. You know, I've played in the biggest games in the world and the worst games in the world, but this just sucks.